Hola a todas y a todos.
Perfect. Hello
por estar compartiendo con nosotros.
Thank you for being here with us.
Quinta sección de Democratic Socialism and Global
Perspective,
la internacional organizada por el Transnational Institute y the Havens
an international
Right
conference
Center
organized
for Social
by the Transnational
Justice.
Institute and the Havens Right Center for Social Justice.
My name is Mabel Duites Rey.
I'm a professor at the University of Buenos Aires. I am actually the director of the Institute for Latin American and Caribbean Studies of the Social Sciences Faculty of the same university. I'm also part of the Claxo Study Group, States in Dispute. I will be the moderator today.
Quiero agradecer muy, muy especialmente a Lala.
You want to give a big thank you to Lala, Isabel, and Liz for providing translation throughout this conference.
Y están haciendo todo lo mejor posible para que muchas más personas puedan participar. Realmente están haciendo un trabajo maravilloso.
And they're doing a great job.
Esta sección se titula el estado
This session is called The Crisis of the Capitalist State and the Democratic Socialist Response.
Soy realmente muy, muy complacida con las personas que van a compartir con nosotros esta discusión. Ahora las voy a introducir
I will introduce
a cada
each speaker in more detail.
Brevemente, porque después le haremos una exposición más detallada de sus respectivos currículos.
I'll introduce the speakers now and then in more detail before they speak. For now, I want to mention who they are and welcome them to this discussion.
The
panelists are Lucio Oliver from Mexico, Jeff Weber from Canada,
Jorge
Viaña from Bolivia,
and
Costas Lapavitsas
and
Spiros Marquetos from Greece.
Hay algo especial que me complace mucho es que en este panel, además de por la temática que compartimos, estamos compartiendo con un grupo de un par de compañeros que integramos el grupo de trabajo de Claxo y que recientemente hemos sacado un libro sobre los estados alterados
states,
en medio de la pandemia y la verdad que es un
pandemic.
Gran gusto para nosotros haber
and
sacado hace muy, muy poquitos días este libro que estará disponible en la plataforma de Claxo y en todas las plataformas que lo quieran distribuir.
And different platforms that want to distribute
it. Before
giving a more full introduction
cada uno de los, oradores de hoy,
to
me
each
gustaría,
of today's speakers,
conversar sobre el formato, más o menos brevemente. Cada
I'd like to talk about the format briefly.
Tendrá alrededor de 20 minutos,
each
después
panelist
de los cuales,
will be given around 20 minutes.
Tendremos alrededor de 30 minutos para un intercambio
after which we'll
abierto.
Have 30 minutes for an open exchange.
Ustedes pueden compartir sus preguntas a través de la
you
sesión
can share
vía
your questions throughout the session through the Q&A button.
Que está en Q&A, botón. Que está en la parte superior del
panel
de Zoom
y
arriba en la pantalla, ¿no? Siéntanse por favor libres de mandar mensajes por el chat.
Send messages in the chat.
Pero si tienen alguna pregunta para los panelistas, por favor asegúrense de que
panelists,
esa pregunta
though, do make sure
se quede asentada
in the Q&A box,
en el control de panel de Zoom.
In the
por
Zoom
favor.
Control panel.
Bueno, también los convidamos a que hagan preguntas y contribuciones de otros panelistas de la conferencia
from other conference panelists,
que estarán hablando entre sí, ¿no? Así vamos a poder
who will be speaking at other parts of the conference. That way we can have a greater exchange among the panelists.
Y si ustedes quieren, lo pueden preparar.
You
mientras
can prepare your comments while panelists finish speaking and send along your questions.
Así dichas estas cuestiones organizativas,
with those logistics out of the way, I would like to introduce our first speaker,
nuestro querido colega,
our dear colleague, Lucio.
Lucio
Oliver is a professor of sociology at the National University of Mexico, UNAM,
Universidad Federal de Ceará de Brasil,
and of the Federal University of Ceará in Brazil.
He's
a former member of the executive committee and a current member of the research group
Secretarías del Estado en América Latina de Claxo, ¿no? Es un Latin America activo of Claxo, participante the Council of Social Sciences. Es poco lo que está dicho aquí porque podríamos hablar muchísimo de las contribuciones del gran
forever Lucio, about
además es un
Lucio's
conocedor privilegiado de la obra de Antonio Gramsci, uno de Antonio los profesores de Gramsci en América Latina.
And one of the most important professors on Gramsci's thought in Latin America.
A presentar ahora a nuestro orador de Canadá, que es Jeff Weber,
Jeff Weber.
Asociado
Jeff
Weber
is an associate professor in the Department of Politics at York University in Toronto. He is the author of several books on Latin America, including The Last Day of Oppression and The First Day of the Same, The Politics and Economics of the New Latin American Left. He is also co-author, alongside Frank Godishan and Massimo Modonesi, of The Impasse of the Latin American Left, which will be coming out soon.
De Duke University Press. Después tendremos la participación
de oradores
de griegos que son Kostas Lapavitsas y Spiros Marquetos,
que compartirán
la presentación
usando algunos
minutos más de tiempo seguramente.
Using a little bit of extra time.
Kostas es profesor de economía y es
Kostas
un
ex-representante
de Syriza y
and
de,
a former representative of Syriza
popular
and later
en el Parlamento
of Popular
griego.
Unity in the Greek Parliament.
Él es columnista de Guardian.
He is a columnist for the Guardian.
Este periódico inglés y es autor de Profiting Without
and the author of
Producing and
Profiting
Against the Troika.
Without Producing and Against the Troika.
En 2007, Lapavitsas
founded
Grupo de Investigación del Dinero y
the
la
Research
Finanzas,
on Money and Finance Project,
sobre dinero y finanzas,
which has contributed
que ha contribuido
original
a
analysis,
análisis originales sobre la crisis de la eurozona.
On the Eurozone
en 2016, siguiendo su salida del Parlamento griego, fundó la red de investigación europea y de política económica social, que es una red internacional de activistas y científicos sociales que desarrollan un plan alternativo para Europa. Siros enseña historia de las ideas en la
History
Facultad
of Ideas at the Faculty of Political Sciences
en Thessaloniki desde
Thessaloniki
el año 2000.
Since 2000.
Fue un activista contra la deuda griega muy temprano. Comenzó a militar muy pronto y es un miembro del Debt Trust Committee
of the
Hellenic Parliament, que actualmente conduce el Comité de Educación de Ellen Pasé, la Confederación de Greek Roma
of
people,
the Greek
¿no?
Roma people.
Del pueblo de Roma, el pueblo de Roma griego. De greco-romano, del pueblo greco-romano, perdón ahí.
Los gitanos griegos.
El pueblo gitano.
El pueblo gitano, ahí está.
The Roma people.
Ah, no
not
me...
the greco-roman people.
I couldn't understand this. Okay.
Okay.
La palabra a Lucio.
We now give the word to Lucio.
Buenos días a todos.
Good morning
espero
to
se
everybody.
Escuche bien.
I hope you can
es un gusto
well.
Estar en este evento. Agradezco la invitación para esta
Thank
actividad
you for the
de New Politics
to participate 2021. In this New Politics 2021.
También agradezco el apoyo y la participación del Grupo de Trabajo sobre Estado de Claxo.
Claxo.
Me voy a permitir exponer 8 puntos para trabajar esta temática.
To think about the subject on the crisis of the capitalist state
que se han abierto para
and the spaces that have opened up
y
to dispute
al final,
its hegemony.
Dos de los 8 puntos serán sobre la situación, cómo veo yo, cómo aprecio la situación de México. En primer lugar, quiero decir que
To begin, I want to say that the actual moment of crisis
in the areas of the world here represented, especially in the two Americas, of the North and the Latin America,
lectura más viva y profunda de las relaciones sociales, políticas e ideológicas presentes bajo las distintas formas dominantes. La crisis del Estado permite a los intelectuales y a los agrupamientos populares a entender y considerar críticamente la relación del poder político con el movimiento orgánico del capitalismo. B. Realizar una lectura teórica e histórica crítica de la relación orgánica Estado-sociedad civil. C. Evaluar la situación de la fuerza popular real en el juego de fuerzas existentes. La situación actual de crisis del Estado en Occidente es propicia porque es un hundimiento de las formas aparentes que acompañan y encubren el dominio y la hegemonía actuales. Los intereses, los proyectos reales de las organizaciones políticas e ideológicas y las relaciones de fuerzas normalmente ocultas afloran en la superficie, de tal manera que es posible para grandes masas interpretar por sí mismas el sentido profundo de los conflictos y proyectos en juego y asociarlos con las contradicciones y problemas profundos de la sociedad. Por lo mismo, épocas como estas de crisis históricas del Estado abren la posibilidad de un desarrollo político acelerado
of an accelerated political development of the masses in society. It opens the opportunity previously unthinkable and stable
son también un momento de aprendizaje de los asuntos del poder para las grandes mayorías, about power, for the great majorities, about its weaknesses and
insufficiencies regarding the real power.
Dos. El Estado es un orden político ideológico que va mucho más allá del dominio de las élites del poder y del poder de las clases económicas dominantes. Es una institución y un vehículo de hegemonía sobre y de subalternidad de las masas. Por lo mismo, el Estado no podrá ser transformado sin profundizar la democracia, sin crear una nueva voluntad colectiva popular, nacional e internacional,
that is national and international, that rises in both organization and conscience, that is capable of being a political force
to dispute the cultural, political direction in society
and to generate an alternative of great politics, a new democratic socialist order, such as we have mentioned in this event.
This voluntary will, a voluntary collective will, requires processes
has had processes as this one in past civilization.
Fragmentada y local de cambio
now
social,
it is fragmented
no
and local,
desarrollada en la
but,
mayoría
and there is
de
not yet developed in the majority of capitalist societies and in this region of
y
the
es
Americas,
una gran necesidad histórica y
and it is a great political and historic necessity.
Para enfrentar la crisis
it is necessary
del capital
face
y a las
the structural crisis of capital and the anti-popular machineries of the state
avance,
for the whole of society to
advance
with political and ideological autonomy
in
its conscience and in deployment of a great politicization of society as a whole. In my presentation, I present the following theoretical
primero,
tenets.
O tercer punto general. El
the
Estado
third general point.
Es el vehículo
the state is the privileged vehicle of a complex hegemony that is deployed both in political society as in civil society.
Hoy,
today,
necesitamos entender al Estado capitalista,
we need to understand the capitalist state in its
integral,
evolution
como
as a whole,
institucional de
as a set of institutions and political relations, and as a political ideological relation of forces that interact and constitute a political society, civil society, and
communitary
en el marco de una original societies
de un orden
in the framework
económico
of domination.
Y político,
of an economic
hegemonía.
Order with hegemony.
Ya hemos alcanzado el momento de
we have achieved the moment
moderno,
of maturity of the modern state, which has
ha
achieved
llegado a un alto nivel,
como to forma a high level as a political form of order of capital relations, and as a parliamentary institution that is hegemonic in society. This conception has its roots in common sense, in the social realm, a common sense which has been formed alongside almost 200 years, and which maintains the individualist liberal paradigm, which thinks of society as a political society, and of the state as an abstract form.
Permite the hegemony hacer del dominio of the state allows una política de inclusión subalternizada de las masas. Subalternized inclusion. A partir de ello, la afirmación y el tremendo despliegue del dominio del Estado a través de sus formas burocráticas, legales, legal administrativas, policíacas y militares, de control y represión se ha afirmado a través del tiempo. Desde el siglo pasado, since the last century, public power has been accompanied by a broadening of the ideological plane,
de líneas de dirección of lines of direction de la educativa de la sociedad, in education a la que contribuyen of society, los intelectuales which masa, intellectuals formados en la educación formal e informal.
In the informal
la cultura,
and formal education,
como política del poder,
in culture as a politics
la que actúa,
of power,
en el ámbito which político, acts. La subsunción hegemónica se produce a través del Estado parlamentario que prevalece en la mayoría de las sociedades contemporáneas. La sociedad aprueba la legalidad y legitimidad del juego parlamentario. La formación de consensos por medio de los representantes políticos y funcionarios de las burocracias y del juego de mayorías y minorías,
and the game of majorities and minorities, independent of the national differences in the form of the state.
Esto tiene un significado histórico.
This has a
es el
historic
momento en que
meaning.
El Estado se constituye
it is the moment where
como gran
the state
ecuación entre sociedad política y sociedad civil. Y esa ecuación está hoy
society,
en una crisis
and that
en que no se corresponde
crisis,
sociedad política y sociedad civil. En las crisis se
crisis,
posibilita activar el proceso formativo
it is
crítico
to break this process,
por la vía del aparecimiento y despliegue de una
way
praxis
of
popular.
Deployment of a
se acelera
popular
la educación política
political
de masas
education
y la incorporación de la intelectualidad crítica
and the incorporation
a la lucha
of critical
social y política
intellectuals
en la que se
to this process
la hegemonía.
Contribute to the dispute of
cuatro.
Hegemony.
El declive
Four.
De la hegemonía
the decline
por medio
of hegemony
de los estados burocráticos
through bureaucratic national states
en América Latina.
In Latin America.
Las actuales crisis políticas
the current
del estado
political
de América
crises
Latina
of the state in
Latin
America, America
son resultado de un
are the result
of
a fan of popular
una manifestación
unrest and discontent,
de un amplio cuestionamiento
of the broad questioning of Latin American
sobre la forma
última
de la hegemonía del capital
latest
y del Estado,
of
los
the
estados
state,
de competencia,
the states of
cuyo proyecto dinamizador es subordinar la economía y la política a la priorización cuasi exclusiva de la valorización del capital.
Of the valuation
esos
of capital.
Estados these states connaturales al proceso de concentración y centralización del capital y al predominio de sus formas financiero
predomination of the speculative
en las últimas cinco
valuation.
Décadas in a través de la política decades, y la ideología neoliberales los estados
policies,
de competencia fueron impuestos por los gobiernos de los estados imperialistas, las élites
states,
políticas mundiales, las grandes
elites,
corporaciones, las maquinarias militar-industriales y las tecnocracias económico-financieras. El estado de competencia ha destruido la soberanía de los estados nacionales, ha impuesto la transnacionalización de las políticas públicas y el debilitamiento de las formas políticas que procesan la lucha interna de intereses y fuerzas. Cabe recordar que en América Latina los estados nacionales fueron una forma tanto de la expansión del capitalismo interno como de la resistencia de la sociedad al dominio de las élites y vía de conquista de libertades, derechos y soberanía en sus recursos. Bajo los estados de competencia se debilita la autoridad del Estado en la sociedad, se desintegra la economía interna,
internal
crece la acumulación ilegal y criminal,
illegal
y la hegemonía pierde
grows,
muchos elementos de legitimidad ante la incapacidad de las instituciones para atender las reivindicaciones populares,
garantizar derechos e impide canalizar los reclamos y propuestas en su carácter de libertades de las mayorías populares.
And incapable of
Cinco, la actual crisis orgánica, tanto política como de hegemonía del Estado.
The actual organic
en nuestros días, la situación del Estado en tanto vehículo complejo de la hegemonía del capital sigue existiendo. Pero desde 1973 se han presentado fenómenos nuevos de múltiples elementos que han llevado progresivamente a su debilitamiento y a la crisis en el siglo
XXI.
Las crecientes dificultades de la hegemonía dentro de los ámbitos nacionales de los diversos países de las Américas tienen relación con las formas oligárquicas del dominio del capital bajo la globalización contemporánea. Debido a sus políticas excluyentes, bárbaras y desiguales, que afectan sobremanera a las grandes mayorías de los trabajadores y destruyen economías, territorios y poblaciones de los países periféricos. Hoy día existe una crisis de hegemonía del Estado. Esa crisis en muchos lugares ha devenido crisis orgánica, cuyo elemento distintivo es la separación y distancia como un todo de la sociedad civil respecto de los estados y las políticas de las distintas élites dirigentes. Recordemos el lúcido planteamiento de Gramsci sobre que el Estado es la suma orgánica de sociedad política y sociedad civil en términos de poder. Si hay separación en esos ámbitos, es que está en cuestión la hegemonía del Estado y la unidad amplia del poder. La correspondencia entre sociedad civil y sociedad política es la condición de la hegemonía. La no correspondencia expresa y pone en crisis al Estado.
Crisis,
Seis, crisis orgánica del Estado.
Six, the organic crisis
Se puede decir que hoy, cuando debilitado y en crisis, sigue prevaleciendo el momento del Estado como hegemonía política y civil y como orden del capital. La subalternidad ideológica y política de las mayorías despolitizadas, fragmentadas y desorganizadas sigue siendo el elemento central que sostiene la actual supremacía de las clases oligárquico-capitalistas. Pero hoy está la crisis de la hegemonía, tanto en la reproducción de la economía como de la política, la cultura y del Estado. La lucha de resistencia y los logros democráticos en la crisis están generando elementos con los cuales se abre la oportunidad y posibilidad de ir conformando un proyecto de voluntad colectiva nacional popular en que la política del día a día se pueda articular a un programa histórico de gran política y un proceso de democracia popular y emancipación. El concepto de crisis orgánica está relacionado al agotamiento tanto del orden del capital como del Estado hegemónico. Nos propone nuevas reflexiones y muchos interrogantes, en tanto se presenta como una crisis de la viabilidad de los diversos proyectos nacionales, de todo el espectro ideológico, político y de la relación de la sociedad política, sus fuerzas históricas, sus proyectos ideológicos políticos y sus políticos de derecha y de izquierda con respecto a los movimientos sociales y comunitarios. Es decir, la crisis orgánica expresa un distanciamiento de toda la sociedad política respecto de la sociedad civil en su conjunto. Vivimos hoy un importante momento de crisis orgánica del Estado que está dando lugar a la retomada por las élites de nuevos estados de excepción o en el otro espectro a la instalación de reformas que tienden a generar estados democráticos populares abiertos que no existían en otras épocas. La situación parece mostrar cómo realidad de fondo, un equilibrio catastrófico de fuerzas, sin que ninguna fuerza, ni de derecha ni de izquierda, logre una ascendencia plena en la sociedad civil.
propicio para la entronización de nuevos cesarismos carismáticos de cualquier signo charismatic
Caesarisms.
Hay un segundo fenómeno. Ante el debilitamiento hegemónico, las élites neoliberales tienden a privilegiar el elemento de dominio y control. Optan por el recurso al estado de excepción y al fascismo de la sociedad.
They opt for fascism and
el tercer fenómeno.
Lucio, te queda un poquito, dos minutos.
El tercer fenómeno asociado a la crisis del Estado es la tendencia de la sociedad a resistir y cuestionar electoral y políticamente al Estado neoliberal existente por medio de sus diversas luchas, lo que da lugar a que se manifiesten ya los elementos autónomos de la sociedad. 7. En México, debido a un extremo de corrupción y desnacionalización de los partidos del orden del capital, la actual crisis política del estado de competencia neoliberal une dos impulsos vitales. Uno, la tenacidad de un proyecto político capitalista nacionalista, crítico del estado de competencia neoliberal, dirigido por un caudillo de masas que ha conformado un movimiento partido.
That has
y dos, a el impulso popular de descontento y hartazgo con la exclusión, la subordinación y la precarización, impulso que busca recuperar la política y hacer avanzar la politización de la mayoría de la sociedad, especialmente los sectores pobres, desorganizados, precarizados, que viven de su trabajo en las ciudades y en el campo. Ambos impulsos están actuando en la actual crisis del Estado mexicano para crear la potencialidad de un nuevo momento constitutivo de un Estado democrático que exprese una nueva sumatoria de sociedad política y sociedad civil en el sentido integral. Sin embargo, las perspectivas hegemónicas de avanzar hacia un nuevo Estado democrático popular hegemónico son aún inciertas. 8. La lucha en democracia de las masas populares mexicanas. Estamos ante un problema teórico, político, que afecta no solo la evaluación de la situación mexicana actual, sino a una apreciación de la situación en las Américas. ¿Cómo entender la política que expresa a la sociedad civil real y concreta, con el específico carácter y abigarrado y pobre acumulación ideológica política en cada país? ¿Cuáles son sus componentes en tanto fuerza ideológica política estatal en sentido amplio? ¿Cómo caracterizarla? ¿Cómo valorar sus potencialidades en relación con lo que se ve de una sociedad política activa y dominante? Es evidente que no prevalece aún una sociedad civil que exprese la hegemonía política y cultural de una determinada concepción activa y autónoma ético-política de democracia popular. Es decir, la sociedad civil realmente existente en México todavía no se configura como el contenido ético-político de un nuevo Estado transformado, avanzado y alternativo. Se trata de la lucha de la sociedad por generar una nueva voluntad colectiva nacional popular, formarse, autoformarse como sujeto activo en las formas sociales y políticas disponibles, disputar la democracia y la hegemonía, además de recuperar el Estado y sus instituciones históricas nacionales, transformándolas. El movimiento partido que hoy sustenta al gobierno de López Obrador, tiene un alcance nacional y popular evidente, pero su fisonomía es todavía un bajo nivel de politización y de conciencia programática autónoma. Por eso, la profundización democrática y la política avanzada, democrática socialista en nuestros términos, es lograr en la crisis del Estado y en el actual momento constitutivo la politización autónoma y crítica de la sociedad popular y el reconocimiento colectivo en que todo el pueblo se reconozca entre sí, como planteaba Hegel, en que los movimientos sociales populares del campo y la ciudad se reconozcan en las reivindicaciones también de las clases medias y de los movimientos indígenas. Las elecciones a los diversos puestos políticos que hoy son para impulsar dirigentes y su capacidad de hacer política como burocracia
people into la opción do politics de transformarse without bureaucracy,
para construir una capacidad social de hacer política, propiciar una política popular autónoma de masas. El partido anclado en el movimiento tendrá sentido en la medida en que actúe y logre que una sociedad popular pobremente organizada y con un bajo nivel de conciencia crítica logre superarse y entenderse como sociedad popular que construye política y que politiza el conjunto de la sociedad.
Lucio, estamos en tiempo.
Sí, ya estoy terminando.
Estamos en tiempo.
Pero hace falta encontrar las formas de modificar la conciencia para que los sectores activos de la sociedad, los dirigentes populares, las clases medias, etcétera, se vean en relación con la situación y problemas de las grandes mayorías precarizadas y fragmentadas nacionalmente. And el neoliberalismo ha creado una conciencia individualista muy fuerte en el que los individuos no se reconocen con los otros individuos de la sociedad y no aprecian su situación. Para lograr hacer política y dar fuerza al impulso popular
and to give strength to the popular
que está actuando
impulse,
en México hoy, es fundamental que haya ese reconocimiento nacional y social que permita que lo político sea de todos para todos. To be y que lo político of determine for la everyone,
and that politics
para ello
really
el Partido Popular Morena tiene como opción que la política electoral sea una convocatoria a que la sociedad discuta los problemas y las soluciones locales,
problems,
nacionales
and
e internacionales.
Local,
muchas gracias.
Muchas gracias, Lucio. Ahora le damos la palabra a Jeffrey Berber. Gracias, Jeffrey.
Gracias, Mabel. Thanks to everyone. Thanks especially to Patrick, Pete, and Daniel, and Sarah, and others who organized, who are organizing, who I haven't met. It's a real honor to be here. I also want to apologize to other panelists in earlier panels who I wasn't able to attend. Work obligations have prevented me from attending much of the rest of the conference. I would have liked to have been there. So what I want to do today is to characterize in the broadest possible terms the dominant features of three periods of the so-called pink tide in Latin America. The first is a period of movement resurgence between the late 90s and roughly 2003, a period of state occupation between 2003 until roughly 2013, and a period of uneven retreat between 2013 and today. These three political cycles in turn, loosely, if not mechanically, map onto respective economic periods of regional recession, a commodities boom, and the delayed effects of the global crisis, first an economic crisis and then the viral crisis into the Latin American region. So the purpose is to think through each of these periods in terms of the interacting dynamics of three elements, the anti-systemic left and the populist left, crisis and state forms. The basic argument here is that populism in both its left and right guises has been the preeminent exit route from various crises in Latin America since the 1930s. Left populism, while a preferable outcome to right-wing forms of domination that have taken form in modern Latin American history, needs nonetheless to be seen as a competing strategic horizon to the anti-systemic socialist left. Left populism, even while providing temporary material gains to the laboring classes, has repeatedly tempered, channeled, and moderated their autonomous and antagonistic activity and potential. Left populism, through the contradictions of its multi-class foundations, has also repeatedly laid the foundations for its own crisis and the emergence of various articulations of the right to take advantage of that crisis of left populism. So let's turn to the question of populism itself, obviously skirting over a whole series of debates to just present my position on this. The resilience of populism in Latin America since its inception in the 1930s is closely related to the persistent structural heterogeneity of the laboring classes together with an extreme general inequality in the region, the most unequal region of the world to this day. And this structural heterogeneity and extreme inequality, obviously not at the exact same levels, but as a general feature of the region, has persisted across different modes of capitalist accumulation in the modern period. Import substitution industrialization from the 1930s through the 1970s, neoliberal orthodoxy through the 80s and the 90s, and in through neo-developmentalism of the 21st century. And neoliberal orthodoxy persisted alongside neo-developmentalism in different regions, different parts of the region over the first parts of the current century. So following Philip Oxhorn's typology, if not his political conclusions, populism can be understood in Latin America as having been characterized by four predominant features. The first is that populism is characterized by an asymmetrical multi-class coalition. Replacing the fundamental labor-capital antagonism, populism instead offers an ideologically ambiguous multi-class framing of the people, seen as the true essence of the nation, pitted against the dominant power bloc, which changes in its composition depending on the period you're talking about, and which at different moments might or might not include an opposition to imperialism, at least rhetorically. Layers of the working class and peasantry are mobilized, but they lack autonomous organizational capacity and power. And the multi-class coalition is dominated by interests of the middle class and sections of capital. The second feature that characterizes populism in Latin American history is that it mobilizes broad popular support. Populism, in fact, depends on the mobilization of the laboring classes. At the same time, it seeks to control, channel, and temper that mobilization so as to avoid its autonomous capacities escaping the channels directed by populist regimes or the radicalization of those laboring class capacities outside of the strict perimeters of the populist regime. The third is that populism is paternalistic and elitist in its leadership style. The fundamental organization is top-down and hierarchical. Classically, this involved charismatic, relatively unmediated leader-mass relations, but such charisma is unnecessary, as later iterations of populism without charisma in the region suggest. The final character of Latin American populism in broad terms, as I'm using it, is an instrumental use of ideology. The very reproduction of the multi-class heterogeneity of the populist coalition demands a concealing and ambiguous ideology of the so-called common people, who again are the genuine expression of the nation, pitted against an enemy. And that enemy changes, but is effectively the anti-nation in different varieties. Material redistribution of some kind must play a role, but populism is premised on tempering class conflict, focusing instead on integration through national development and the expansion of economic growth. The idea is to minimize the notion in which capitalist development is a zero-sum game in which some classes lose and some classes win, but rather a mutually virtuous cycle, except for the minimally excluded enemy, whoever that is defined as. Populism seeks both concessions and cooperation from the capitalist class rather than its abolition. Populist movements in Latin American history are repeatedly connected to crisis, and these crises in Latin America are repeatedly connected in mediated ways to the historical cycles of accumulation on the world scale and Latin America's subordinate integration into that world capitalist market and the reproduction of that subordinate international division of labor over time. Classical Latin American populism in Brazil, Mexico, and Argentina across the 1930s and 1940s responded to the simultaneity of the emergence of industrial working classes, the growth of the middle class, incipient industrialization, and the dislocations wrought by the Great Depression. While the classical populist movements subordinated the working class to the interests of industrial capital, the former, the working class, nonetheless realized substantive material gains, at least while the expansionary period of import substitution industrialization facilitated the lubrication of the multi-class coalition, holding it together, cohering it through the distribution of some material gain, such as important rights, gains in collective bargaining rights, extension of social security benefits to at least small sections of the organized working class, and improved wages and working conditions for this organized layer of the class. When import substitution industrialization entered into crisis in the 1960s, these coalition of multi-class factors fell apart and the antagonism between their different interests came to the fore. Anti-systemic left forces therefore emerged to try to forge a socialist exit to the crisis of import substitution industrial capitalism. But they were systematically defeated and crushed in the bureaucratic authoritarian regimes of the 1960s and 1970s, which in turn laid the foundations for the neoliberalism to come over the next two decades. A later crisis then precipitated another distinct populist exit. Out of the debt crisis of the 1980s, forms of right-wing populism emerged, consolidating by the early 1990s in, for example, Fujimori's Peru. Following years of repression and neoliberal restructuring of class relations, at no time in modern Latin American history was a socialist left alternative more discredited as unviable than in the early 1990s. In that context, the so-called enemies against which right-wing populism mobilized the common people in the 1980s and 1990s included corrupt state managers and the notion of an ostensibly bloated and bureaucratic developmental state through which rent-seeking and corruption was preventing was the fault of the marginalized oppression and poverty.
Targeted... Jeffrey, te queda poquito. Te queda andar redondeando.
Targeted and minimalist anti-poverty cash transfers, subsidies, and lines of credit were the material lubricant of right-wing populism vis-a-vis the laboring classes, particularly the informal proletariat over the 1980s and 1990s. This was tied to the ideological idealization of the individual and survival strategies for them through the market. Now, just as the exhaustion of import substitution industrialization in the 1960s catalyzed the military authoritarian response of the 1960s and the 1970s, and the debt crisis of the 1980s sparked the counter-revolution of neoliberalism, a new crisis set the stage for the pink tide. Between 1998 and 2002, South America in particular entered into its worst aggregate recession of extraordinary contraction of growth since the early 1980s debt crisis. And out of this crisis of neoliberalism, a genuinely organic crisis of neoliberalism in the region emerged through the extra-parliamentary anti-systemic articulation of new forces of the social left, if not a political left. There was a wide diversity of social subjects involved: unemployed workers, formal sector workers, indigenous movements, peasants, women, youth, students, and so on. These movements between the late 90s and the early 2000s were autonomous and antagonistic, with a significant, explicitly anti-capitalist component, obviously to uneven degrees across the different countries. These movements were plural, but interconnected movements in their antagonism to the rulers of the crisis of neoliberalism in that period. The most extraordinary examples of extra-parliamentary revolt in this period that I'm talking about were in Argentina in the early period of the 21st century, the very first couple of years, in which a series of governments fell out of power in Ecuador, led by a rural indigenous movement, CONAIE, the Confederation of Indigenous Nationalities, but linking together urban working class sectors under their hegemony. And most extraordinarily in Bolivia between 2000 and 2005 with the left indigenous insurrectionary cycle beginning with the Cochabamba Water War of 2000 through the so-called gas wars of 2003 and 2005. The point here is that this was a moment which broke with populism and saw an anti-systemic element to popular antagonism taking the foreground. It lacked, however, the political capacities to articulate an exit to that crisis, which it helped induce, the element of that organic crisis. And this moves us into the next period that I want to talk about, 2003 to 2011, which is characterized as a left populist moment that absorbs that earlier anti-systemic moment. And this has to do in part also with the change in the historical cycles of accumulation on the world market as Latin America is imbricated within it in a subordinate position. Because while between 1998 and 2002, Latin America was in, particularly South America, was in a deep recession, between 2003 and roughly 2011, depending on which country you're referring to, South America was as a whole redynamized by the commodities boom, which was in turn driven mainly by the rapid industrialization of China, driving up the prices of mining minerals, of natural gas and oil, agro-industrial commodity exports such as soya and the like. It was in this context that left populist governments that come to office throughout South America between 2003 and the mid-2000s were able to delay a certain set of class questions or conceal a certain set of class questions around the multi-class coalition that they had put together. That is to say, they were able to achieve simultaneously a modest redistribution of income, significant declines in poverty rates, the introduction of new social programs around health and education with serious material consequences for those who received them. At the same time, they did this without a challenge to the property relations underlying the class structures that they had inherited. And net profitability of capital, both foreign and domestic, inside of the extractive sectors, went up over this period relative to the 90s, almost systematically across the cases. And that obviously couldn't endure. It was dependent on the continuity of high commodity prices. So this was rooted also in the intensification of extractive capitalism, mining mineral expansion, natural gas and oil extraction, agro-industrial monocropping, which in turn led to new contradictions of dispossession and conflicts, especially beginning in 2011, 2012, between indigenous left movements against extractivism and these left populist states in places like Ecuador and Bolivia, for example. So that multi-class coalition, fragile as it was, is unsustainable when the conjunctural dynamic of a supportive international market changes. And the instigation of this change, the instigation of a new situation, is the 2009 crisis of, or the 2008 crisis of global capitalism, but in Latin America, there is a delayed reverberation of this, a delayed set of effects. And that is because, especially in South America, the deep turn to East Asian commercial relations meant that the immediate downturn in the Eurozone and in the United States does not undermine the growth potentiality of South America in that period.
Jeffrey, te queda nada. Redondea, por favor.
Okay. I've been speaking for 17 minutes, but okay. I'll just wrap up with the with a word on the last period then. The key thing about the current moment of the pandemic is that it corresponded with a crisis of an already existing recessionary crisis between 2016 and 2019, and then on top of this, the worst economic crisis in the region in over a century of statistical data. And in that context, you have a crisis of left populism, the revival, so the removal of several regimes from office, and the resurgence of a right-wing populism, most dramatically expressed in Jair Bolsonaro in Brazil, but in other areas as well. But this isn't a simple shift from left hegemony to right hegemony, but rather an impasse because the left does not have, or sorry, the right that is ascendant does not have a conceivable exit to this crisis. And therefore the right, often when it enters office, is unable to deal with this crisis and retreats from office. Argentina, Mauricio Macri is defeated by Alberto Fernandez. Luis Arce in Bolivia ushers in the return of democracy after the coup in Bolivia and so on. But these are debilitated left populist regimes, even weaker than they were in the past. But I guess I've reached time, so I will end it there. Thanks.
Thank you, Jeffrey. I'm sorry for the the interruption. Now is going Costas Lapavitsas, the SOAS, University of London. He's going to use around 10 minutes. Then he's going to give the word to the Spiros, and then both of them are going to share the final words.
Actually, I will open up. Costas. Actually, I will open up very quickly, and then Spiros will take over, and I'll come back. Anyway, it's a pleasure to be with you. It's we both, Spiros and I, appreciate greatly the event and the opportunity to speak. What we will do is present to you some early results from a project that we've been undertaking in London, but also in other countries of Europe, which we've called COVID meets capitalism, or capitalism meets COVID. And part of that is obviously a discussion of the state and the politics of it. It will come out as a book produced by Verso later in this year. We analyze financialized capitalism all the way to 2020 when COVID hits. And in that, we'll look at the extraordinary role of the state in financialized capitalism, its dependence on the state, but also the oligarchic structures of class power that have emerged as financialized capitalism has become more mature. And also the new forms of core and periphery divisions that have emerged in the world, the reemergence of a periphery in unexpected places the last two decades. The pandemic shock casts light on all these issues, and that's the purpose of our project and of our book. The role of the state today, as was demonstrated in 2020, is without precedent in the history of capitalism. This is capitalism that depends thoroughly on the state. All that talk about the opposition between markets and states and the market dominating the state has been shown to be complete codswallop. The truth is contemporary capitalism depends on the state. And our work points that out, and also brings out some considerations about how the left should position itself in the face of this transformation of capitalism. And for that, we will use some of the experience of Syriza in Greece in the previous decade, mostly to find out what not to do, not what to do, right? Mostly to find out what to avoid. Anyway, without further ado, Spiros will now discuss the political and social dimensions of how financialized capitalism has changed, and then I will discuss more particular details of how COVID has unfolded the last year. So,
hello from me as well, from Europe to all our listeners and the distinguished scholars from South America with whom we are sharing this panel. We look forward to having a productive discussion. Our intervention focuses on the European Union, and we analyze some of the interventions of the implications of the social and political shock of COVID for the political outlook of the left. And highlighting the social content of the European Union's public health policies employed to confront the pandemic, we discuss the active role of national states in the current economic and social crisis. And we, first of all, we try to distinguish between the leftist projects and the conservative and liberal political projects that are currently redesigned in Europe and which the left must respond. We cannot adequately examine all these issues in a short talk of 20 minutes. Thus, we present only some basic points, while several others are dealt with in our book. We use the term liberal in the European sense, denoting political agents that promote liberal economic policies and not in the usual American fashion of anything to the left of the Republican Party. Liberals, conservatives, and the left form the three historical political camps in Europe, with distinct positions on fiscal policy, monetary policy, protecting workers' income and conditions, as well as on the importance of democracy and popular sovereignty in the face of oligarchy. Oligarchy is something about we're hearing more and more nowadays, and there is something in this. The first step that the left must do is to consider more closely the content of democracy and oligarchy under current conditions of financialized capitalism. And both are closely connected to the extraordinary escalation of inequality in recent decades. This is the social and political background against which to begin to assess the enormous impact of the pandemic and some of its implications for the strategy of the left. With these points in mind, we finally turn to political developments in Greece, a country where the left momentarily posed a challenge to the power nexus in the previous decade, because Greek events provide an object lesson in what the left ought not to do in confronting capitalism, and especially at this conjuncture of the pandemic. Democracy and oligarchy are two words created in ancient Greece. Democracy, at least in the sense in which Aristotle typically used the term, referred to the poor and propertyless, the people without a stake in the regime, who were then the backbone of the demos, this was the word, and they, in democracy, are taking the important decisions themselves and in their own interest by controlling the executive and judiciary mechanisms of the state. In oligarchy, by contrast, power belongs to a few people of great wealth and often of high lending capacity. Debt is another of the leitmotifs of our book. The rise of European democracy in the modern era has typically involved debtors revolting against lenders. In the period of financialized capitalism, oligarchy is an appropriate term to denote the enormously disproportionate power of the top layer of capitalists over the body social, acquired through economic strength. The wealth of capitalist oligarchs derives from property over productive resources, typically in the form of shares, as well as property over loanable capital. Their objective is profit, industrial and financial, accruing through production and exchange, but also through capital gains and speculative operations in the realm of finance. Wealth and power for oligarchs further derives from their position in the structures of governance of the large multinationals and the financial institutions that are pivotal to the world market. So today, capitalist oligarchs have accumulated wealth and power so huge that they can influence politics to protect their economic interests and social privilege, and thus continue accumulating ever more wealth and power. So they are the top layer of capitalists. Not all capitalists are oligarchs. The vicious circle thus created leads to social Darwinist policies favoring the strongest, entailing social polarization and the increased concentration of wealth in ever fewer hands. Privilege reigns, although it is often considered more or less clumsy. Reinforced by both market and institutional mechanisms, this vicious circle can be broken only through committed and radical political intervention that involves both economic and political transformation. The time to effect this transformation is when crises break out. During periods of growth or apparent normality of accumulation, oligarchic privilege tends to be naturalized or ignored. But in crisis, its function cannot be easily concealed or beatified. On the other hand, crises can also be critical moments for the deepening and entrenching of oligarchic privilege. Their outcome is uncertain and much depends on the conscious intervention of broad social strata and the left. And the pandemic crisis is one such moment. Moreover, the stark but usually unmentionable fact is that oligarchic preponderance over the economy is incompatible with democracy in any way that we might define the latter beyond the purely formal and procedural. Democracy is unattainable in societies where wealth and power are very unequally distributed. And these are our societies, actually. There is an emptying of democratic practice from within and its replacement by effectively oligarchic practice, often while retaining the outer form of democracy. So political democracy is precluded by the huge inequalities span in financialized capitalism through both the exploitation of labor in production and expropriatory accumulation, which is another phenomenon of our era. Class boundaries in capitalist societies have hardened, with economic and social inequalities becoming exacerbated through the active support of state institutions captured by oligarchs. So the dividing line between the left and other political actors in contemporary capitalism is that the left realizes that oligarchic power must be broken and oligarchic wealth must be returned to society. These changes must happen soon, or they will not happen at all. Moreover, it is important to be reminded by the famous declaration of Abbé Sieyès around the time of the fall of Bastille, that the nation was the third estate. That is, only those who did not enjoy the ancien regime privileges. The privileged orders, meaning clergy and nobles, were excluded from the nation that was then being formed. Equality, democracy, and the leadership of the nation are ideas that ought to be inextricably linked in any programmatic stance of the left. Social inequality in Western societies has now returned to pre-French Revolution levels, as Thomas Piketty and Gabriel Zucman have shown. The left should certainly demand raising the income of the poor, but this is hardly enough. It is also necessary to break oligarchic power and to socialize oligarchic wealth. These demands ought to be publicly stated programmatic aims of the left, not merely wishes and demented sotto voce. They are historic objectives of the socialist left and not accidental consequences or byproducts of philanthropic social engineers. Destroying the power of capitalist oligarchs is a matter of life and death for all those who aim for radical change, as has been attested by radical historians who have grappled with the role of counter-revolution in the last 2.5 centuries, and above all, Arno Mayer. Now, if radical political change does not take place, including the expropriation of the oligarchs, there will continue to be an eclipse of democratic rights in parallel with the growing inequality of wealth and income characteristics of the decades of financialization. A central mechanism in these processes has been debt and its servicing. Canceling the debt of the weak to the strong, nationally and internationally, is both a basic measure of social justice and a democratic aim that can turn into a popular demand hitting directly the oligarchs. It is closely connected to the creation of a strong socialized banking system, which is also a central and necessary plank of any left-wing program. More necessary than ever, both these objectives will be furiously resisted by capital. As long as the left fails to give them due prominence, it leaves the field to the right. Actually, there is empirical evidence that the United States is an oligarchic regime, and it is a safe bet that the European Union is no more democratic. In the course of the pandemic, and in a manner reminiscent of the interwar years, both liberals and conservatives have progressively set aside institutionalized political rules. However, the tendency to evade constitutional restrictions is of course older and has much deeper roots. The radical Johannes Agnoli noted long ago that the question of whether the developing supranational oligarchies, the economic, the political, and the cultural, will consider it necessary to submit themselves to the inherited bourgeois rules of constitutionality is open. The acuteness of the social conflicts which loom on the horizon seems to raise much doubt that this would be indeed the case. And we see in the United States now what this means. So it would be a strategic mistake for the left to take formal democratic procedures at face value. More realistic analysis notes that today we don't have liberal democracy, as it is usually called, but just a constitutional oligarchy that actually becomes less and less constitutional. Why do we insist on putting forward our own definition of democracy and focusing on the realistic analysis that necessarily highlights actual configurations of power? Because the left must avoid turning into an auxiliary of the liberals or the conservatives whenever strife within the oligarchy escalates, as it actually happens in moments of crisis. Since the 19th century, the left succeeded in creating its own political space only when it stayed away from both liberals and conservatives, while fighting those in power and usually distancing itself from both camps. So, tailing others in politics has always been the safest route to irrelevance. And unfortunately, the left did this sometimes. It is a matter of survival for the left today to regain its autonomy from both conservatives and liberals, certainly in Europe and obviously in America. But for this, we need a comprehensive political program giving due prominence to destroying oligarchic power and expropriating oligarchic wealth. And this is obvious in the conjuncture of the pandemic, for which Kostas will talk. Thank you.
Okay. I want to give a little bit of insight into how these ideas, which are the basic political framework, or much of the political framework, what we're doing, how they fit into an analysis of COVID as we've experienced it in Europe and other parts of the world the last year. Now, it seems to us, and you know, we've got a large research group here in in London looking into it, and actually across Europe, about 15 people. But it seems to us that COVID is clearly a class disease, and we're not being original in saying that. That is well understood now. COVID is a class disease, and it's a class disease because it hits fundamentally the poor, workers, marginalized people with underlying health conditions, and so on. Now, given that it is a class disease, we feel and we've argued, as have others in England and elsewhere, that a grassroots strategy would have been appropriate for containing and confronting COVID. Now, a grassroots strategy, we argue, had the certain has certain characteristics, certain features to it. It involves tracing, it involves targeting particular outbreaks of the disease and with free testing available locally. It involves saturating mass dispersion areas of the disease, particularly workplaces, transport, and so on. It involves making resources available to those who have been affected by the disease so that it can be treated with dignity and so on. And within these confines, it also leaves room for these restrictions and possibly lockdowns locally, depending on particularly vicious outbreaks of the disease. In other words, restrictions and lockdowns are not the first port of call. They're actually a tactic that should be used depending on other circumstances. Now, grassroots strategy was not adopted. It's not been adopted in most places, certainly not in the core countries of the world economy, in Europe and elsewhere. Why? Because obviously it's a strategy that would have affected oligarchic interests, as Spiros outlined them, oligarchic interests associated with privatized health services and closely connected to Big Pharma and the biomedical sector, about which I will have more to say in a minute. It would also have challenged structures of power within financialized capitalism right at the core. So a grassroots strategy was never seriously contemplated. Instead, several states went for restrictions and lockdowns, with everything this means for the poorest and the weakest in society. The same structures of power, the oligarchic elite that basically sets the terms of how the disease has been confronted, is also seen in terms of producing the vaccines. The production of vaccines is a tale of capitalist chaos, competitive chaos, when you actually look at it closely. It involves national competition among nations, and big business competition among multinationals. The combination of the two is the direction of capitalism ahead. National competition and multinational competition, big business competition. How were the vaccines developed? They were developed through basic research undertaken over many years through public funding. They were developed through programs of public support for the research. They were also developed through the state buying in advance huge amounts of potentially produced vaccines, and therefore removing the risk from Big Pharma in terms of production. The outlook then, a year into it, is that we've got dozens of vaccines under development. Several of them in Western countries, some of them in China, some of them in Russia, some of them in India, dozens of vaccines of variable quality, variable price, and all competing with each other for access to the broad masses across the world. How will the broader masses of the poorer countries get it? It's unclear at the moment. COVAX is the best answer that we've got. COVAX, an initiative undertaken by Bill Gates, effectively, there's some incredibly rich people, ramshackle initiative, put together any old how, which is very unsteadily financed, and there is no guarantee that the poor of the world will be able to access sufficient amounts of these vaccines through that. In other words, an oligarchic arrangement across the world that looks after the interests of big business, the biomedical sector, and pivots around national competition. Similar points, and perhaps even stronger, could be made about the economic response and the social response of the state to the crisis. What we've witnessed, in addition to this ramshackle health response, what we've witnessed across the core countries of the world is an astonishing emergence of the state to intervene in economy and society. There is the recession induced by COVID was to a large extent caused by the state. Capitalism was weak in 2019, for sure. The world economy was weak, but it's the state intervention to impose lockdowns that induced the unprecedented recession of last year. Even more astonishing than that is, of course, the intervention of the state to deal with the recession. And that intervention shows you where power lies and the nature of class privilege in today's capitalism, because the first and most important part of the intervention was, of course, monetary policy, whereby control by the state over fiat money, absolute monopoly over fiat money, allowed the state to support an extraordinary expansion of liquidity, giving money to banks, to corporations, and so on, based on public credit, and therefore to overcome the shock that the recession had created. On top of that, we had an extraordinary expansion of fiscal policy. The fiscal steps undertaken by states in 2020 are without precedent. Essentially, states have nationalized part of the wage bill and part of the income statement of a huge range of corporations without, however, nationalizing equity. In other words, leaving property untouched for the moment. Support, in other words, has gone for huge support has gone for big business that controls financialized capitalism and big finance that also controls financialized capitalism. The worst was avoided in a way, and the outcome has been a bubble in the stock markets, which is currently of epic proportions. There is no bubble that can be compared to what's happening at the moment in the United States stock markets and elsewhere. One last interesting piece of development in 2020 is that as all this has been happening, the balance of power across the world among different national powers has of course been dramatically changed. The balance of the struggle for hegemony between China and India and the United States has accelerated, and the United States is not winning it at the moment. China is having the better of it for the moment. The United States is not finished, but China is certainly more successful in dealing with the shock of COVID. Now, what does this mean for the time ahead? It is with this that I want to finish this part. COVID will be over at some point, sometime in 2021, possibly early 2022, depending on how the vaccine disaster unfolds. What will then emerge will be a struggle on how to pay for the crisis. As Spiro said in the first half of the presentation, moments of crisis are moments of contestation. The oligarchic elite, which sits at the top of the most powerful capitalist countries, has done everything it could so far. It has used all levers of power to strengthen its position. The issue that will emerge when the worst of COVID is over is who will pay for the crisis? Who will pay for it? How will the costs be apportioned? In other words, what will happen to the huge fiscal deficits and the accumulation of debt, particularly by states, but also by large and smaller corporations? That will be what the struggle will focus on, and the left must be clear about it. The left must oppose it, and it must oppose it on the basis of opposing oligarchy power, on the basis of attacking the basis of foundations of power of the oligarchic elite that has created this absurd system. That would involve an alternative program of economic growth and development, and it would involve a challenge to debt, refusing to pay it, and a challenge to property. There must be proposals put across that actually put equity and ownership of the resources on a different basis, both for finance, but also for the productive sector. That to me seems fundamental in positioning the left separately from other political forces, and actually reestablishing the radical credentials of the left, which have been dramatically weakened the last few decades. The biggest example of how the credentials of the left have been weakened, and with this I want to finish, I'll give Spiros another minute or two, is of course Greece and Syriza. Now, I'll just mention it very quickly, just to exemplify what I mean by
Kostas, do you have 1 minute, please?
Yeah, yeah. Syriza is an excellent example of what the left must not do. Because the Greek people voted Syriza in the hope of standing up to the lenders and in the hope of standing up to the domestic structures of power. That would have required a rupture. It would have required precisely the kind of break that Spiros and I mentioned with regard to oligarchic power. It would have required challenging the Greek oligarchic elite and destroying its power, its economic power, but also its political power. That was necessary, and that was tied up with exiting the monetary union and saying no to the foreign lenders, defaulting on the debt. It would have been impossible to do otherwise. Syriza talked a lot, promised a lot, but when it came to that, it balked. It stepped back, and that included all the leadership of it. It included even Yanis Varoufakis, who likes to present himself as a great radical while he wasn't. Because he didn't do that, because Syriza did not challenge the power of the oligarchic elite in Greece and the power of the lenders, it compromised. The result has been a disaster. A disaster for the left, a disaster for the Greek people, and a historic retreat of the left. The Greek people used to look towards the left as the political agent that is honest and promises possibly a different future. At the moment, they don't. They don't look like that. They don't look to the left like that because of the experience of Syriza and the betrayal of these ideas by Syriza. That's what the left must not do again in Europe, confronted with COVID, or in the United States, confronted with COVID, confronted with the challenges post-COVID. The left must take a radical position, and it must challenge the institutions of power and the power of the oligarchy in the economic sphere. Without that, I don't think there is any historic future for the left. It will continue to decline, and that will be terrible for societies and for humanity as a whole. Thank you.
Ahora le damos la palabra a Jorge Viaña, nuestro compañero de Bolivia.
Buenas tardes a todos y a todas.
Hello, good afternoon Bolivia. To everybody from Bolivia.
Quisiera agradecer especialmente
I would like
a
to thank especially all the organizers.
No voy a citar a nadie, tal vez
I'm
solo
not
going to
name anyone, only Daniel.
No sé exactamente, pero muchas gracias a los organizadores.
But thank you to all the organizers. It is a privilege to be here in this exposition with such interesting panelists, and I want to thank Mavis.
Moderación. Bueno,
for
un saludo
her
a todos,
moderation.
A Kostas, a Jeffrey, a Spiros, a
to Kostas, to Jeff, to Spiros.
Bueno,
thank you all for your words.
Yo quisiera, I would like digamos, to hacer esta exposición básicamente,
do this exposition
planteando una cuestión que me parece
suggesting
fundamental.
A question that I think is fundamental.
He tenido el privilegio de exponer después
I've
de
had
ustedes,
the privilege of
y
exposing after
que
you,
en una medida
presenting
voy a
after
pasar
you.
Ciertas cosas
and
que
I think a lot of what I'm going to say
Jeffrey,
will be based
Spiros,
on what Jeffrey, Spiros, Kostas have said.
Muy
I think they've
muy
been fascinating presentations, very important. What I'd like to emphasize is the problem on the possibility of the construction of socialism.
La crisis del Estado es
obviously,
un tema
the crisis of the state is a fundamental question, but I think the possibility of constructing socialism, as we've seen in the presentation made by Spiros, Kostas, and Jeffrey, is our norm. What do we do to construct deconstruct socialism, ¿no? What do we do to get closer to building socialism?
Entonces, a ver, voy a tratar de plantear el proceso boliviano y el proceso venezolano en una lectura,
explain the Bolivian and Venezuelan processes in a reading
se puede decir comparativa,
that we could call is comparative
de aportar al debate
to try to contribute to the debate on the construction of socialism.
Voy a empezar primero
I'm
diciendo
begin
que,
first by saying
voy a hacer algunas alusiones a
that I'm
going
to make some
Rusia
allusions to Cuba, to Russia, and some
que me parece
processes
muy
in Europe that I think are very important. Because
en las que sobre
all
todo
this was condensed in the discussions that Che had in the 60s on the construction
lo primero
of socialism.
Que habría que decir,
the first thing
es
we should
que,
say
ver, Latinoamérica, y eso
is that
yo hago
Latin America,
a que hagamos
and here
un
I do a call for
norte global y el
doing
global,
you know,
hacer
combined
un
work
del
of the global north and global south to study the struggle
bueno,
for socialism.
Hay que partir de,
in Latin America,
de Antonio Meya, de Recabarren,
we need to start from Antonio Meya, Mariátegui, Martí, and many others
20, 30,
who in the
20s de una forma
thought about socialism
que se está
in a way that's very different than the way we're discussing
Podría,
it now,
Zabaleta,
which is why I bring these thinkers to the fore, also Zabaleta.
A ver, y ¿qué es lo que quisiera partir diciendo? Que
okay, what do I
después
want to
se envileció tremendamente el debate
later,
sobre el socialismo
the debate got very entrenched.
Digamos así, por el disciplinamiento
because
de la,
of the discipline
digamos, de los partidos comunistas,
of
sobre
the
todo,
communist
por ejemplo,
parties, especially.
Nunca quiso estar
for example, Mariátegui never wanted to be part of the communist party.
Pero para llegar a un punto fundamental,
but to get to the fundamental
la revolución
point,
cubana rompió
the Cuban revolution
con, digamos,
broke completely
la fosilización del
with the fossilization of Marxism
en los años,
that
40,
happened
50.
In the 40s
y
and 50s.
¿Cuál es el tema de fondo?
And what is the
¿cómo
most
es
important
posible
thing?
Que
how
Cuba
is it possible that Cuba
digamos, de una
transitioned
nacional
from a national anti-imperialist revolution
hacia el socialismo en 27
towards socialism
meses. ¿Cuál
in 27 months? How do we explain this?
Que da,
and the explanation
Heredia,
that
Martínez
Heredia,
cubano,
who is a Cuban
tiempo,
and just died unfortunately a few years ago,
Heredia,
we have to study him further, we need to study Latin American Marxists, but he basically suggests
que había Marx,
this idea of that the permanent
digamos,
revolution that Marx had suggested
y que otros grupos,
and that other Bolsheviks
en los
took
años
up
20, 30,
in the 20s and 30s.
Sepultado.
You know,
¿por qué estoy hablando
buried
de esto? Porque
why am I talking about this?
También hay que estudiar Jorge
because
Luis Acanda,
I think it's also important to study Acanda,
intenta construir el socialismo,
saying that Cuba
es del socialismo,
to build
y no bases para llegar al socialismo algún día.
And not bases to
entonces,
get to socialism someday.
¿Qué retoma la revolución cubana?
So what does the Cuban
la necesidad
revolution
fundamental,
bring up? Fundamental
de partir con las medidas socialistas
with
y no solamente
measures,
como lo han explicado Jeffrey
and Sparrow
un populismo que elude la posibilidad por ejemplo
the
de como lo han planteado los compañeros hay que romper con el poder y la riqueza
of
oligárquica
with
lo digo
Cyprus, power,
o,
as Spiros said.
O digamos la redistribución de los ingresos
or the
y no
of
retomaron, digamos, no retaron las
and
relaciones de propiedad. Eso dijo
the relations of
no retaron
property,
las relaciones de propiedad. Incluso
Jeffrey
hay que ir más allá.
We have to go
pero yo
further
retomo la revolución cubana y como se conoce
but
ampliamente, yo creo
revolution
que habría que plantear,
know,
bueno,
I think it's
fue resultado
to think about
de, digamos,
the fact
un proceso
that it was
antiimperialista
the result
de,
of an anti-imperialist
de desarrollo nacional
que
remata en medidas socialistas, expropiación
measures,
de las refinerías, expropiación
of the
de,
sugar
digamos, el capital industrial, el capital comercial,
capital,
una reforma
capital,
agraria amplia porque casi todo el
territorio estaba because all of the land
la
was in the, you know, belonged
etc.
to
bueno,
the oligarchies.
Conocido,
as we
no
all
voy a
know,
profundizar.
I'm not going to deepen
pero si
on
quiero
these,
poner el ejemplo
but
de
I do
Chile,
want to give the example
y después pasar
of Chile
a Venezuela y Bolivia.
And then pass on to Venezuela
el gran debate
Bolivia
para construir socialismo
the great
no solo
debate
si es que
for constructing socialism
de
is not only if we have possibilities of going beyond capitalism in
sino
abstract
de construcción
terms,
de lo que por
but
lo
of
menos un reformismo mucho más avanzado
a reformism that is far more advanced
Allende,
such as we saw in Chile.
Si bien se planteaba como una vía pacífica
Allende,
socialismo, tomó medidas radicales para una transformación profunda y puso en jaque al capital industrial, al capital financiero y al capital agrario.
All kinds
ojo,
of capital,
Venezuela y Bolivia,
agrarian,
Bolivia no ha hecho eso nunca.
Etc.
Es decir, Venezuela or Bolivia have not done this. That is to say, a reformism that is far more advanced, that tried to nationalize between 90 and 110 companies, and they did so. They nationalized copper, carbon,
se nacionalizó y se controló el comercio
they
exterior.
Nationalized
se
profundizó commerce.
La reforma agraria.
They
estoy hablando
with
de Chile.
The reform.
Es decir, Allende, como un reformismo
that
progresista,
say, Allende
era muchísimo más avanzado que por lo menos la experiencia boliviana
far more
actual.
Advanced than the current Bolivian
por ejemplo, case. Incluso en temas de la reforma agraria se hablaba
in
de una expropiación,
reform,
incluso a la gente que tenía más de 80 hectáreas. Pero
even for people with over 80 hectares.
A gente que tenía incluso 40 hectáreas.
They did it even to people with
¿por qué estoy
over 40
hablando
hectares?
De esto?
Why am I
porque además,
about
por ejemplo, la indemnización del cobre en
1971
fue una expropiación sin indemnización.
It was an expropiation
entonces,
without indemnization.
¿De qué estamos hablando cuando hablamos de Chile?
So what are we talking about when we talk about Chile? I'm talking about a progressive reformism
that had profound, de poder popular. Y este es
that
el
had
el
profound popular power.
Había la construcción de los cordones industriales
there was the construction of the industrial
belt obrero.
That
había
attempted to
de
reconstruct
las que eran
worker power. There were comunas that were territorial unities built from below. And that was recuperated in Venezuela. The HAP. The juntas
es decir,
de abastecimiento
había
y de precios,
una
the price
necesidad
commune.
Que se surgió desde abajo de construcción de poder
that
popular.
Emerged from below to construct
yo creo que en gran
power.
Medida Bolivia fue completamente
Bolivia
al revés de esta experiencia. Completamente
the opposite
al revés.
Of this.
Y Venezuela la
Venezuela
intentó construir
did try
desde
to
2010,
build it,
2011, 2012,
starting in
que voy a tratar 2010, de explicar.
11 and 12.
Entro al tema de Venezuela y Bolivia.
I'm
going to
talk about Venezuela
now. Tiempo, estoy
I hope I have enough time. I have 7 minutes.
A ver. ¿Cuál es el debate fundamental?
Okay, what is the fundamental debate?
Venezuela hubo un intento
Venezuela,
de golpe en el 2002.
There was a coup
y el
2002, in 2002,
la gente,
and in
la movilización de masas es la
the
que
people,
salvó
the
a
masses were the ones
Chávez,
who saved Chávez.
Se empezó a dar una profundización
and
del proceso.
We saw a deepening
¿cuál es
of
el
the
elemento
process?
Central de la
what's
construcción
the central element
de la lucha
of the construction
en Venezuela?
Of struggle
yo diría
in
la
Venezuela.
Construcción de poder popular.
I would say the construction
que
of
se basa
popular
por
power,
lo menos en siete
which
elementos
is based at least in 7 elements.
Uno, tratar
first,
de recuperar y superar la experiencia chilena, que había sido un gran dilema, por ejemplo, el problema del ejército.
Dilemma, example,
Venezuela sí realmente
army.
Incorpora al ejército
Venezuela really
en este debate,
the army
en esta
debate,
resolución
in
de un dilema para la revolución
of a
socialista.
For the socialist revolution.
Ahora pueden decir, sí, hay corrupción,
now we can say,
el
yeah, there's corruption,
poder,
the army has
desastre.
Too much power,
sí, claro,
it's a disaster, yeah, okay.
Hay muchas críticas que se
there's
pueden hacer
a lot of critiques
pero incorpora
to be done.
Al ejército.
But they did
Chile no logró resolver
army.
Ese problema.
Chile did not
un segundo
to
tema muy importante, la construcción del Estado comunal.
Also important, the construction
la
of the
Estado
communal
comunal,
state,
que era la idea de Chávez,
which
empezó
was Chávez's
a plantearse
idea,
ya como ley en el 2010, tres años antes de que muera Chávez.
In 2010,
y tenemos ejemplos interesantísimos de la comuna de Maizal, la comuna de Simón Bolívar y cientos y miles de comunas. Pero, ¿cuál era el centro que resolvía? Y que Bolivia fue contrarruta de esa visión. La construcción
vision,
de poder popular,
the construction of popular
que seguía
power,
profundizándose, por ejemplo, después de la muerte de Chávez en el 2016,
Chávez,
con la construcción de los CLAP. Y fíjense, incluso trata de retomar la experiencia más interesante, pero que venía desde abajo en Chile, de los HAP, que eran las juntas
the HAP,
de abastecimiento y precios. En el caso
and
venezolano,
prices,
son las CLAP. Pero ¿qué otra cosa fundamental resolvió
what
el
else,
tema de Venezuela
was
como construcción de poder
Venezuela
popular? Una gran reorganización organizativa del PCV que viene en 2006
PCV,
y el 2007. Se
Chavez's
articula
party,
una organización política y organizativa de lucha de masas. Bolivia fue completamente contrarruta de esta experiencia. Jamás
that.
Hizo un intento de intentar
Bolivia
articular una estructura de movilización del MAS como una organización de lucha de masas de construcción
mass.
De poder popular. Un otro elemento fundamental.
Another fundamental point.
La construcción dentro de esta articulación de poder popular, Estado comunal y una gran reorganización organizativa de la construcción de las milicias. ¿Ustedes por qué creen que los gringos no invaden Venezuela?
Why do you think
porque
the Americans haven't invaded Venezuela? Because there's militias, there are organized militias, even the Deutsche Welle says that there's 3 million people organized in these popular militias in Venezuela. Now, we can make a lot of critiques. la
Venezuela, there's corruption, the bourgeoisie, you know, the army, I'm sure is very corrupt and so on. But there is a fundamental solution that is planted for the revolution and which Latin America needs to recognize. The question that Spiro planted, which is a question of decolonization.
Ejército incorporado al proyecto.
So we have an incorporated army, communal state,
las milicias the popular power, para the organized militias
to defend the revolution, a great transformation of organizational transformation of PSUV as a struggle of the masses. And the second element, they have transformed the correlation of forces in Venezuelan society where the mass struggle is fundamental in every moment of state action. Bolivia also did not do this.
Y por lo tanto, se ha dado un elemento fundamental del debate por la construcción de una lucha socialista que es el problema del doble poder.
Element is that of double power, dual power. Why in Venezuela is there a parliament that is of the opposition and a parliament that is of the state? With all this question of legality of the bourgeoisie and democracy, well, at least in proto-stage as in Bolivia in the 70s, there is the discussion of dual power. We are in Venezuela before a partial revolution, political revolution, that managed to advance elements of popular power, which no other Latin American country has done, you know, recognizing the challenges of Chile and Cuba.
Entonces, ese es un tema fundamental. So no podemos esperar a que lleguen
we
las
cannot
condiciones.
Wait for the conditions.
Perdón, Jorge. Jorge, por favor, habla un poquito más lento para que las traductoras te puedan seguir.
Bueno, mil disculpas, me emociono un poco.
Apologies to the interpreters.
Este debate para la construcción del socialismo requiere de un análisis concreto, que es lo que planteaba Lukács, húngaro, sobre la importancia del análisis leninista. Lenin dice, es una cuestión concreta. No podemos esperar
a que haya condiciones for there to be conditions, such as the fossilized Marxism says, that the productive forces have to clash with so-and-so, and then we can have anti-capitalism. No, this is the way for the construction of socialism, although there are a lot of necessary critiques. Although there are many valid critiques to Venezuela.
Proceso boliviano,
I'm going to go to the Bolivian case, trying to make an analogy with Cuba and Venezuela again, because it's hard to articulate everything that I need to say.
Este
why is this
porque
debate so important? Because
de la
there is a fundamental question
60.
On Che in the 60s. In the 60s, Che was minister
de industrias,
of industry and planted the question of the central planning committee. And what he was questioning is that we had these two great tendencies in which what could not be done was to make dominant the position of the Che so that the other tendency of the construction of socialism retreated. So Che left a letter to Fidel when he was questioning these forms of socialist organization in the Soviet Union, in Czechoslovakia, and Yugoslavia.
Me parece muy importante,
this is something we need to incorporate into the debate, and it's important because we are trying, as Spiros and Costas and Jeff said,
en una retroceso
we
de
are
la lucha
in a retreat of the struggle for socialism in
ni
Latin America.
Estamos a la altura
we are not
che,
even at the height
of
the popular unity of Allende in Chile. As
ese
I have demonstrated, that is reformism, progressive reformism. But he was installing the fundamental elements for the construction of power to struggle for socialism, although they were saying it was constructing the basis for socialism. The experience shows the Chilean experience tried to build from socialism the basis for socialism. Venezuela is the only experience that has attempted in this partial revolution to cement the elements of the construction of socialism.
No.
The others didn't. Bolivia
voy a tratar de demostrar.
And I'm going to Bolivia try to demonstrate fue una parcial revolución Bolivia was a partial political revolution.
Luchas entre el 2000 y el 2005, un ciclo estatal de las luchas con Evo Morales de 14 años, en los que no se hizo nada de lo que explicaba sobre todo respecto a Venezuela.
To do, en el 2010 ya empieza una atenuación de esa parcial revolución política,
que no quiere decir que siendo parcial revolución política sea una lucha por el socialismo, no era.
A political revolution doesn't mean that it's a struggle for socialism.
Interesantísimo. Y bueno, ya no hablaremos de Brasil, que ni siquiera pudieron lograr
Brazil,
que se tenga mayoría en el parlamento. La derecha seguía teniendo mayoría en el parlamento. Ya
the
no
right
hablaremos
still
de Argentina,
managed to hold on to that majority.
Que era un, el
or not
proceso,
or
yo
let's
creo,
not talk about Argentina,
estatal,
which was a process of the Kirchnerist cycle
no
of the infinite peronism.
Ahí.
Where there's
ahora,
not
no
a trace of socialism.
That's not to say that
we have to be against
pero
everything
entonces,
that those governments did, but
Ecuador es posible
what has happened?
Como
Ecuador,
por el
we can
de una
think of it as an attempt to try to get a political
eso.
Revolution, but
Bolivia
I don't think they even got that. Bolivia is a partial political revolution that began to weaken in 2010 and collapsed in 2019. And that's
porque
the central
Bolivia,
element,
sí, hubo
because
de
Bolivia, there was a coup, but there was a coup based on the great mistakes that the mass committed,
en parte Jeffries,
you know, described
etcétera,
by the other speakers,
que la cosa más
so
del mundo.
That the most unthinkable thing happened,
en el,
Evo
en el
Morales
en el
was left alone.
Las masas no salieron
the masses
a defenderlo.
Did not go out to defend
entonces,
him.
¿Qué nos mostraba eso? Un
so what does that
total,
reveal?
Una estrategia de desmovilización y una incapacidad de comprender la necesidad de construir poder popular. Es más, desde el 2010-2013-2018, jamás las masas fueron necesarias para la política estatal, jamás. Y fueron sistemáticamente desmovilizadas. Entonces, este es un tema fundamental. Yo quisiera que logremos comprender, y estoy a 17 minutos, voy a tratar de acabar en 3 minutos,
fíjense bien. Esta experiencia latinoamericana
this
debe
Latin
ser comparativa histórica y teórica.
Compared,
necesitamos entender qué pasó realmente en Chile,
political.
Por qué
we
la revolución cubana
Chile, en la visión de Fernando Martínez Heredia, que es una revolución
Heredia,
permanente que en 27 meses pasa del antiimperialismo nacional al socialismo, que es interesantísimo, y comprender dos cosas más que quisiera incorporar en el debate para no ser puramente sur-sur global.
To
yo quisiera incorporar el debate de Hungría. ¿Qué ha pasado con
Irme
Maggi? ¿Por qué es ejecutado? Toma el poder en el 56 y es ejecutado en el 58. ¿Qué es lo que ha pasado en Yugoslavia? Tenemos que entender qué ha pasado,
we need to understand
sur,
what happened there.
Yo le exigiría a Sisek y a todos los eslovenos, ex-yugoslavos y todos los de ahí, que nos den elementos de un análisis como lo han hecho Cyprus, etcétera, de esto, por ejemplo, Yugoslavia.
For example,
en 1945 inició
Yugoslavia,
socialismo, pero independiente
in
de Stalin, después Stalin
we got socialism,
de
and then Stalin expulses
pero la
people from
sobre todo
coming
de Czechoslovakia. ¿Qué ha pasado en Czechoslovakia?
But also the experience of Czechoslovakia. What happened
¿y por qué
in Rudolf 1949 Slansky acaba ahorcado
en el año 52?
Hanged in
ojo.
52.
Y la experiencia de Czechoslovakia que
and
se vuelve a repetir
Czechoslovakia,
la experiencia
which repeats
que
again,
se plantea de las reformas de los años 60.
Of the reforms of
fíjense
the 60s.
Bien, Czechoslovakia entra
Czechoslovakia
en un proceso de reformas en el 65, 66, 67,
65,
67, 67, 67, 67, 67, 67, 67, 67,
and
y
the,
todo ese proceso
the role
del año
of Dubek
65, 66, 67,
of the
en la primavera de Praga en el año 68 y la invasión rusa para impedir todo ese proceso de democratización socialista. Incluso el Partido Comunista Francés
we
se opuso,
study,
para que no me acusen de ser
anti-stalinista,
el Comunista Francés se opuso
anti-Stalinist,
a la invasión de Checoslovaquia en el año 68.
Ahora,
¿por qué
invasion?
Les estoy hablando de eso?
Why
porque
am I talking
he
about
el debate
this?
Sobre el Che.
Because I've introduced
el Che
the debate
un gran
on
debate
the Che.
Justamente
the
sobre
Che
estos
had a strong debate
cómo
on
socialismo.
These aspects of how to build socialism.
En el año
anda, Jorge, anda redondeando. Así dejamos lugar para las preguntas.
Tengo un minutito.
I have
tengo
one
un
more
minutito,
minute.
Por favor, y ahí voy a acabar. El gran debate entre Bethlen y Ernest Mandel y todos los cubanos tenía que ver justamente con el debate, por ejemplo, de Lieberman, que en el año 62 en la Unión Soviética también se impuso hacer. volvió famoso
also
de las reformas económicas soviéticas del año 65. O sea, todo este debate sobre cómo construir socialismo tiene un punto central en los años 60 con el debate de Lieberman,
with Lieberman's debate in the Soviet Union,
los debates de Bethlehem, Ernest Mandel, y de toda esta cuestión de cómo construir socialismo que incluso impactó en Chile.
That had an impact on Chile, which is what I've been talking
para
about.
Ir acabando, porque ya se me acabó el tiempo, to wrap en 20 up, minutos, Bolivia nunca
Bolivia
construyó
never
una perspectiva
constructed
de poder popular, de poner a las
power
masas como el eje
of putting
de la
the masses
lucha
as the
por
central
la ocupación del poder, y por lo tanto, no es un ejemplo de construcción.
And therefore, it is not an
Chile,
example of socialism. Chile did, even though it was reformist, but it was an advanced reformism.
Y por supuesto, la Revolución Cubana,
and of course,
y toda
the Cuban
la
Revolution,
de plantear entre los problemas
all of its legacies,
checoslovacos, y podría dar otros
and
ejemplos.
Also the
Hungría
del
60 y, del
56,
o Alemania Oriental del 53,
Germany
o Polonia del 56, con Gomulka.
Poland,
y toda esa gran discusión,
so
yo quiero retomar en esta discusión
again in
la importancia y agradecerles, y con eso concluyo, de que hagamos un esfuerzo global,
global
de interpretación más profundo de qué cosas realmente es el socialismo. Chile ni siquiera llegó
really
al socialismo, pero luchó mucho más que Bolivia. Y
but
Venezuela
they fought for it a lot more than Bolivia
con
and
todos
Venezuela.
Los que está intentando construir referentes de socialismo en
and how do we construct reference for socialism
gracias,
in Latin America?
Gracias, Jorge. Thank you. Well, now we are going to open the discussion. And if someone wants to say something or ask something, oh, Constanza. Constanza is going to ask. Constanza was.
Gracias, Mabel. Interesantísimo el panel. Yo,
a very interesting panel.
Me voy, hago una pregunta para Jeffrey.
I'm gonna make a question for Jeffrey.
A quien convido además a nuestro panel
who
sobre
I invite
populismo
to
de izquierda que está mañana
leftist
en la presentación.
Tomorrow.
Ya que su ponencia ha sido
now
sobre
that
eso.
His presentation was about that.
Dos preguntas muy concretas.
Two concrete questions.
La categoría populismo no me convence.
The category of populism doesn't fully convince me.
Y acá ha sido usada siempre con
and
una
I think
carga
it's been
negativa,
used with a very negative charge and has served mostly to contradict certain governments that are popular than to really do a rigorous description of its characteristics.
Pero, más allá de la ambigüedad,
however, beyond the ambiguity
la categoría de populismo,
with this category of populism,
¿por qué la política
why
latinoamericana te
is
parece,
Latin American politics,
¿por qué la política,
why do you think,
or
rather, why is populist politics in Latin America
y en qué sentido Europa está ausente
attributed to Latin America, and to what sense is Europe
porque
missing
si
from this discussion?
La heterogeneidad estructural
because of the structural heterogeneity
populismo,
is a precondition
hay que
for populism,
Grecia,
then we need to hear from Greece
para ver que la heterogeneidad
to see that structural heterogeneity
sí
is also present there.
Y obligar a las masas a que dejen de ser masas y se transformen como clases.
To stop being masses and turn into
bueno,
class. Well,
es así que es una tarea revolucionaria.
That is a revolutionary task.
Yo creo que en los
I think
llamados populismos de izquierda
in the
latinoamericanos
Latin American populism,
hay masa y
you
hay
have
clases.
A little bit of everything.
Hay partidos
you
organizados,
have masses and you have classes. You have organized parties and you have transversal social
tú
movements.
Tú haces énfasis, y esta es la segunda pregunta.
You emphasize,
la
and this is the second question. The first is, why is Latin American populism
para describir Europa,
used to describe
no
Latin America but not Europe?
Y si es la heterogeneidad estructural
the structural heterogeneity
de Europa,
of many countries in Europe, not a precondition for populism. And the second question is,
si en realidad,
if you
en realidad
really,
hay un compromiso de clase en el populismo,
truly a class compromise
¿no?
in populism, which there is.
Hay un compromiso de clase entre capital y
there
trabajo.
Is a class compromise.
Los partidos socialdemócratas también.
A commitment between capital
trabajan
and work.
Sobre la idea de un compromiso de clase.
We are
finalmente,
all operating on a commitment to
Adam
class.
Adam Segursky decía
Adam
que la democracia
said, of democracy
that was unstable,
torn and unstable because it depended on a commitment to class,
and contradictory because it was based on it.
In these electoral democracies of ours, how is it possible
to overcome
that demand for a commitment of
pero,
class?
Como decía Spiros,
as Spiros was saying,
volviendo a los viejos términos griegos,
returning to the old Greek term, struggle is always between democracy and oligarchy, between the government of the poor and the government of the rich. As Aristotle said,
los populismos latinoamericanos,
Latin American populism,
democracias de los pobres,
are democracies
en todo caso
of the
se
poor.
Parece más al viejo concepto
in any
de
case,
demagogia,
it's much closer to the old concept of demagogy
that Aristotle
also used than to oligarchy, but which opposed to the oligarchic projects have opposed
Ecuador,
in Bolivia, in Venezuela, in Ecuador,
con diversas,
and so on,
diversas concesiones, pero
with
en el
broad
campo
concessions,
de las
but within the field of the broad divisions, I do think it, there was an
gracias,
opposition.
Gracias, Constanza. Ahora hay una, vamos a hacer
thank you, Constanza.
Un par de más.
We're
going to
do a few
chat,
more questions. There are in the chat.
Q&A. Some questions that for Jeffrey that Jeffrey chat already answered, but if you want to introduce in your presentations, but Gabriel has a question. I add this.
It's mostly for Jeff, but I think it could be answered by any of the panelists, and it's basically the question of if we do take your point that there is a left populist project which is different from a democratic socialist project, then how should the democratic socialist project in its political or social or other forms relate to the left populist project? Should it be a relation of confrontation, of collaboration, of both? And I'm thinking particularly of Venezuela, where I see the sort of left populist project as being both the most sort of successful in many ways, but also the most fraught and ultimately, I would argue, unsuccessful in the end. And I think that there's also a way you can think about this question with respect to the sort of advanced capitalist countries, the project of Bernie and Corbyn, you know, dealing with Labor Party, Democratic Party, but I'm thinking of it very specifically with reference to the left populist projects within the pink tide. Thanks.
Bueno, gracias. We have 5 minutes. We have to finish. I'm sorry because it's very interesting discussion. We can say a lot of things about these important points. But Jeffrey, I give you some minutes to finish.
I'll try and answer part of this very quickly. Obviously, I can't get to the very many interesting components of it. Constanza asked about, she's unconvinced by the definition of populism as a useful category, and why is this used pejoratively to refer to Latin America and not to Europe? I don't mean it in a pejorative sense in the traditional way that it's used today, which is a kind of colloquial, everyday journalistic version. I'm talking about a quite specific analytical framing, which I tried to defend. And the reason to defend it is because it's distinctive, at least from my opinion, from the socialist project. And that's the polemic, that others see this as a blurry line between the two projects. I see them as quite different projects, which are in contradiction with one another. To go to Gabriel's question, nice to see you, Gabriel. How does the Democratic Socialist Project relate to left populism? The first thing to say is that although I'm speaking at the Democratic Socialist conference, I don't actually subscribe to the framing Democratic Socialist. I'm a revolutionary socialist, but which I think is democratic, but it doesn't need that preface. But how to relate to left populist projects is a massively concrete and particular situation. But in the context of the pink tide, I would just say that the primary the primary emphasis would have to be on the retaining of an independent class politics inside of those experiments. So it doesn't mean in opposition to the mass in government, or that you don't defend the mass in Bolivia against the coup d'etat, but it does mean that you have a project of building an independent class politics outside of that, which isn't dependent upon the party in power. Obviously, there's a lot more to say, but I don't want to take too much time.
Thank you, Shepherd. Costa, do you want to say something, or Spiros, or Lucio, or Jorge also? Costas?
Not particularly. I think just to thank the organizers. I think it was a very important thing, this event, and long may it continue, and, you know, more power to your elbows.
Lucio?
Sí, yo rápidamente Lucio? Creo que en las colocaciones extremas, digamos, de populismo o socialismo expressions of populism or immediate socialism,
we need to el consider hegemony.
El planteamiento de Jorge,
the problem
es
with
que
Jorge's
él está
presentation
como
argument is that he is taking as reference
Cuba, en donde
a place
el poder
like
era
Cuba
dominio,
where
más,
power was dominion
y justamente
and
ahí
more.
Se pudo dar
and just
esa transición
there,
de 24
we saw the
meses,
transition
porque no se enfrentaba con la construcción de una hegemonía profunda.
The construction of
eso
a
es
hegemony.
Pensar que lo que nos falta
that
es solo una radicalidad socialista hoy es un error.
Radicalness
muy
is
grave.
A mistake. It's a very
lo que
serious
se requiere
mistake.
Es una construcción de una nueva voluntad colectiva
will,
que cuestione la hegemonía existente y que permita la construcción de un poder popular democrático socialista.
Popular
lo mismo el populismo,
democracy.
Creo que
same with populism.
Como proyecto político,
I
sí,
think
es un proyecto político.
Yeah.
Totalmente incompleto.
It's an incomplete political
otra
project.
Cosa es una democracia abierta.
Another thing
popular.
Is an open popular
entonces,
democracy.
Yo creo que tendríamos mucho
so I
que
think
discutir,
that we would have to discuss
pero en
a
medio
lot.
Está el problema de la hegemonía,
but
que
the problem
es central
is the question
para
of hegemony,
debate,
which is central to our debate.
Y para darle una salida adecuada
to give
a la crisis
an
del
exit
Estado
to
actual.
The crisis.
Gracias, Lucio. Thank you, Lucio. We don't have any time. I'm so sorry. We are in 10 minutes, we have the next session that we invite you to join us, to join this, to join. And let me stay here. You can be connected and using the same link to enroll. To enjoy the conference, eh? You can stay here. Okay. Thank you very much.